Hi everyone and welcome to chapter 7. In this we are going to discuss about how to value different stocks. So this chapter discusses what are the basics of stocks, what is the dividend discount model, estimate the dividends in dividend discount model, limitations of dividend discount model, share repurchases and total payout model, the discounted free cash flow model, valuation based on comparable firms, information, competition and stock prices, individual biases and trading. What is the learning objective? Describe the basis of stocks, common stocks, preferred stocks and stock quotes. Value a stock as present value of its expected future dividends. Understand the trade-off between dividends and growth in stock valuation. Appreciate the limitation of valuing a stock based on expected dividends. Value a stock as a present value of cash flows. Value a stock by applying multiples. Understand how information is incorporated in stock price through competition and efficient market. Describe some behavioral biases that individual traders have. So let's start. So the first thing that the chapter discusses is about types of stock. So the basic type of stock that you come across is a common stock. So what is a common stock? A common stock is an ownership in a corporation which confirms the right to any investor right to dividend as well as right to vote in elections, right? Where you can choose directors, mergers or any other events. Then the ticker symbol is an abbreviation assigned to a publicly traded company. Okay, so common stock, you get voting. So you get straight voting, you get cumulative voting, and there are different classes of stocks. And shareholders, right, you can attend annual meetings and you can vote by proxy. So I'm going to explain it. So let's open some stock and then discuss it. So if you see, we are looking at Google. Okay. So Google has two classes of share. So you can see there is normal Google shares, right? 1453. And there is one more. The other share, that is 1451. So what's the difference? So Google has issued two types of shares, class A and class B. So I'll open an Excel so that I can explain. Okay, so actually I'll tell you what has happened. So the founders of Google wanted to keep voting with themselves. So they have issued one type of shares and that they kept with themselves. So founders of Google have a type of share that has higher voting rights. Then there are common shares that are given to investors. Amongst them, you can have a normal share and a reduced voting share. So what is happening here? So whenever you buy a common share, generally, what do you get? You get proportionate voting. You get right to dividend and residual right to the company. So what is proportionate voting? Proportionate voting means if you have 1% share, you have 1% voting right. So your voting will have 1% voting right. Okay, that is a normal common share. 1% share if you hold, you get 1% voting right from the company, right? You also get right to dividend and you get residual right to the company. Residual right means if the company winds down, everyone else is paid. So first the bondholders are paid, then the preference shareholders are paid, and whatever is left would be paid to you. So you get residual rights after everyone else is paid. So this is a normal share, proportionate voting, right to dividend, and residual rights. But what happened when Google was raising money? The founders thought that if they give away shares with normal voting rights, then someone else can take over their company and someone else can make decisions on behalf of them, right? And someone like this thing has happened with even Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs was ousted from Apple because he did not have enough voting rights. So new board of directors came in and they removed Steve Jobs. So founders of Google did not want that to happen to them. So what they did was they came up with a concept, or they came up with some shares called as founder shares. So what are founder shares? These are common shares that they have right to dividend and they have residual right. So same as common shares. Only difference is founder shares have higher voting rights. So instead of one share having one voting right, maybe one share has 10 voting rights. So if you hold even 1% of the company, you get 10% of voting rights. Now, what is voting rights? Voting right means you can vote on company policies. So major decisions, then board of directors. So you can vote on major decisions as well as vote on board of directors. So founders wanted to have control over their company. That's why they issued this. And among common shares also, they issued a normal share of Google, which has proportionate voting, and they also came up with a reduced voting share. It means that voting rights are reduced, but these shares carry the same right to dividend and same residual right. So what's the difference? Founder shares, common shares, and reduced voting shares, all of them carry right to dividend. So if dividend is declared, all three are paid, and if the company is wound down, then all three are paid, whatever is left, right? But founder shares have the highest voting preference. Normal share has then voting preference, proportionate, and reduced voting shares have very low voting rights. Okay? Now, also, this is a stock quote. So the company name is Alphabet. It is traded on the stock exchange as GOOG or GOOGL. Okay, and you can see there was a difference of price. So Google was the normal share was traded at 1453, reduced voting rights share was traded at 1451. Now, if you're interested only in making money from Google, you're not interested in running Google, you can very well just buy this share and means buy the shares that has lower price because you are not worried about voting rights as an investor. Okay, if you want to see like TD, it's a bank, so it's listed in TSX. So this is TD's stocks price. The symbol is TD.TO. Okay. And other information is given. So this is how a stock quote looks like. So that was common shares. So what do common shares get? Common shares gets right for voting, they get right to dividend, and they get right on residual assets. So when everyone else is paid, whatever is remaining, they are paid. Next type of shares are preference stock. So what's a preference stock? So let's open a preference stock. So RBC has a preference stock. So this is a preference stock of RBC. This is a preference stock of RBC. There was one more. I'll open that. because they don't give dividend yield in this. So this is a preference stock of RBC. So what is a preference stock? So preference stock has following properties. It has generally fixed rate of dividend. So dividend rates are fixed. If the company makes profit, it will pay dividend, and it will pay dividend at a fixed rate that is mentioned. Okay. Next property, they have preference in payments of dividends and residual value. What does that mean? That before normal shares are paid, before normal shares are given dividend, the company has to first pay preference stockholders. If preference stockholders are not paid, they cannot pay common stockholders. So they have preference in payment of dividends over common stocks. Same way, if the company is closed down, the company first pays debt, that is bondholders, then it pays preference stock, and then whatever money is left, then that is received by common stock. So preference in payments of dividends as well as residual value. Okay. Then few other things, they can be cumulative. Cumulative means if a dividend is missed, the company carry forwards that dividend. Means, like if RBC, we are looking at RBC's preference stock. If RBC misses a dividend payment, then it has to carry forward that dividend payment into future. It has to pay it in the future. It cannot skip it out. Or they can be non-cumulative. Non-cumulative means if a dividend is missed, dividend is missed. It is not carry forward. Okay. So they can be cumulative. So if a company misses dividend in this year, it has to pay it in the future. Or they can be non-cumulative. So if a dividend is missed, it cannot be carry forward. Now, generally, preference shares have no voting rights until dividends are paid. If the dividends are missed out, if company is making losses, then preference shares can get voting rights. But otherwise, preference shares do not have voting rights. Okay. Now, preference shares do not have a time frame. It means generally they are issued in perpetuity. So, preference shares generally keep on paying dividend until either you sell the stocks or the company closes down. So, let's look at an example and understand it better. So, this is an RBC's preference stock. Okay. It has a fixed dividend of $1.2. Now, if you see, even if you click on max, the price generally remains very same, very stable. RBC's preference share price generally remains very same, like similar. Okay, it doesn't fluctuate much. And there was a big drop in this COVID pandemic, but apart from that was not foreseen circumstance, right? But apart from that, the price remains very stable, right? And the dividend yield is 5.91%. So what does that mean? The stock price is $20. So on this $20 stock price, you're almost going to get $6 dividend every year. Now, how long do you keep on getting this dividend? You keep on getting this dividend until two things happen. Either you sell the stock, then you don't get dividend, or RBC closes down, right? Until then, if RBC is continually making profits, then it will keep on paying dividends on its cumulative stock. Okay, 6% dividend on a $20 stock. And one more thing, before RBC pays common stockholders their dividend, because it also pays dividend on common stocks. If you open one more Yahoo page where we can compare normal stock of RBC. It's traded as RY. Let's look at the Toronto one. It will open the American one. It's listed in NYSE. Okay, so let's compare. This is common stock of RBC. This is preference stock of RBC. So if you see, preference stock is $20. Common stock is $95. What is the difference? Both of them pay dividend. So common stock also pays dividend of 4.52%. Preference stocks pays little higher dividend of around 6%. The difference is, if you look, the variation is not there in the stock price. Stock price doesn't vary much because preference shareholders do not get growth in the company. Whenever you invest in preference shares, you only get a fixed dividend. You are not participating in the growth of the company. Same way, you're not participating in the downfall of the company, right? But if you see RBC stock and click on max, it has appreciated a lot. So if you invested in RBC back in 1995, it was $7. So you will be getting paid dividend all this while and also participate in the growth of the company. Okay? So that's the difference. Preference shares do not participate in growth. So let's note that down too. Do not participate in growth. Similarly, you can see also preference shares of TD. I have to go to probably RBC's, means my brokerage account, to see that, because TD is not visible from Yahoo Finance. Okay, but similarly, TD has also issued preference stocks. And let's go back. So preference stocks can be cumulative, where if a dividend is missed, they have to pay in future, or they can be non-cumulative. Preferred stocks are neither equity nor debt. They are similar to debt, they are similar to bonds because they carry a fixed rate of dividend. They are similar to stocks because they pay dividends rather than interest. Dividends are paid when you get profits. Interest is paid before profits. So that's the difference. They are more risky than debt, less risky than equity. Okay. Next, there can be different types of votings when you buy a share. A straight voting, voting for directors, during which shareholders must vote for each director separately, with each shareholder having as many vote as the share held. Cumulative voting, voting for directors, during which each shareholder is allocated votes equal to number of slots open multiplied by his or her common shares. So what does that mean? So I'll explain. So let's say there is XYZ company, and that company is coming up with two director positions. and it has two shareholders, me and let's say Brianna. Now I have, let's say 50, or let's make it little bit different. So these are the two shareholders and there are five directors. Let's make it five, it will be better. So company is appointing five directors. There are two major shareholders, right? I have 30% stock and, or let's say 51% stock, and Brianna has 49% stock. So what is straight voting? Straight voting means each investor has to vote on each director. So each investor has to vote for each director. So my 51% will have majority in all five directors. Okay, my 51% will have majority in all five directors. So what will happen if it is straight voting? Straight voting, how will straight voting work? I can vote for this director, so 51% of the votes will be held by me. 51% will be held by me in each directors, right? And same way, Brianna will have 49% vote for each directors. So I will win 100% of the time. All directors would be appointed by me because I have majority shares. So I will be having, I will be appointing all the board of directors by myself. This is straight voting. The second one is cumulative voting. So what is cumulative voting? Cumulative voting means I can assign my votes, 51% votes, to some directors and she can assign it to some directors. So let's say Brianna is strategic. She says all my 49% vote that I get only go to these two directors. So 49 divided by 2, 24% vote goes here and 25% vote goes here, 25% vote goes here. Okay, she does this and maybe I can assign my vote to all five directors. Okay, so what will happen? I'm dividing my votes into five. She's dividing her votes only into two directors. She's not voting for three directors. So she's cumulating, combining her votes to only vote on certain director positions, not on everything. So what will happen? Three directors I will appoint, and two directors she would appoint, which is much more fair than me appointing all the directors. Okay? So this is cumulative voting. You can accumulate your vote and choose specific topics or specific board appointments on which you would use those votes. So it is much more strategic. Okay? So where do you vote? You generally vote in an annual meeting. So this meeting is held once a year at which shareholders vote on directors and other proposals as well as ask manager questions. A proxy, sometimes you may not be able to attend the meeting, so you can sign a proxy. Proxy means I am assigning my vote to someone else. So a written authorization for someone else to vote on your shares. A proxy contest, a contest between two or more groups competing to collect proxies to prevail in matter. So what happens? Generally, prominent shareholders will connect with other shareholders to get their votes. So let's say if you looked at the battery day that Tesla had and the shareholder meeting that Tesla had, they were trying to stop Tesla from mining cobalt because cobalt is mined in Congo and means it generally has child labor practices involved in mining cobalt, right? So there was a shareholder group that wanted Tesla to stop using cobalt in their batteries, Right now, there is no substitute. Every battery company in the world has to use cobalt, but they are trying to get away from cobalt so that it is avoided. But there was a prominent shareholder group that connected with all Tesla shareholders to collect their votes so that they can stop Tesla from using cobalt. But they did not gather enough votes to change the decision. But this is how a proxy contest can work. Preferred stock, stock with preference over common shares in payments of dividends and in liquidation. So what is a preferred stock? Preferred stock is where you get preference in dividends as well as when the company winds down. Cumulative preferred stock, preferred stocks for which all missed preference dividends must be paid before any common stocks must be paid. So cumulative means if a company skips 1 year's dividend because it did not make enough profits, then it has to pay that dividend in future. So it carry forwards that dividend. Non-cumulative, preference stockholders for which missed preference dividends do not accumulate. Only the current dividend is owned, and before, and that is, the company has to pay current dividend before it pays common stock. Next is the dividend discount model. So I'll explain first. So there are different 1 year investor period, right? How to value it, then concepts like dividend yield, capital gains, then how it differs. So let's do that. So we are going to discuss dividend discount model. Okay. So what this model discusses is, so I'll open the Excel and explain it. So this model says the value of any stock today is a function of total dividends that the stock is going to pay. Function of the value of any stock today is present value is a function of present value of total dividends the stock is going to pay. So value of any stock, the price of any stock right now is a function of total dividends that the stock is going to pay. If you're not going to sell it, if you're going to sell the stock, then you have to consider the selling price. So let's see. So first is, if you're a 1 year investor, so if you're investing in any stock, what are you going to get? You're going to pay a price P0. You're going to get dividend from the stock as well as you're going to sell the stock after 1 year. So if you're a 1 year investor, you're going to pay the price, get the dividend and sell the stock. So what will be the value of that stock today? The value of that stock today is dividend that you're going to receive plus price of the stock that you're going to sell, the stock price that is going to be after 1 year, divided by 1 plus RE. What is RE? RE is required rate of return, also known as cost of equity, right? This is nothing but based on the risk of the stock, how much return would an investor want? Based on the risk of the stock, how much return would an investor want? So I'll explain it. So the formula is value of a stock. If you're a 1 year investor, that is you're going to sell the stock, is dividend that you're going to receive. So dividend one plus, I have to remove the equals to sign, dividend that you're going to receive plus price of the stock in 1 year, whole thing divided by 1 प्लस RE, वेर RE इज रिक्वायर्ड रेट ऑफ रिटर्न ऑन द स्टॉक. RE इज रिक्वायर्ड रेट ऑफ रिटर्न ऑन द स्टॉक. नाउ हाउ डू यू गेट दिस रिक्वायर्ड रेट ऑफ रिटर्न? सो देर इज रिस्क फ्री रेट. रिक्वायर्ड रेट ऑफ रिटर्न RE इक्वल्स रिस्क फ्री रेट प्लस रिस्क ऑफ द स्टॉक, दैट इज रिस्क प्रीमियम. रिस्क फ्री रेट प्लस रिस्क प्रीमियम. व्हाट इज रिस्क प्रीमियम? हाउ मच इज द स्टॉक मोर रिस्की दैन गवर्नमेंट ऑफ कैनेडा बॉन्ड्स? इफ द स्टॉक इज मोर रिस्की बाय 3%, दैट इज द रिस्क प्रीमियम. ओके, सो लेट्स डू दैट. सो लेट अस से वी आर वैल्यूइंग टीडी. ओके, टीडी बैंक, वी आर वैल्यूइंग दिस स्टॉक. ओके, इग्नोर द करंट प्राइस. दिस स्टॉक इज एक्सपेक्टेड टू पे यू $3.16 इन डिविडेंड. सो डिविडेंड फॉरवर्ड इज 3.16, एंड द एनालिस्ट इज एक्सपेक्टिंग दैट दिस प्राइस, दिस स्टॉक शुड ट्रेड एट $67.27. सो लेट्स नोट डाउन फ्यू स्टफ. सो डिविडेंड वन, दैट इज द फॉरवर्ड डिविडेंड, डिविडेंड दैट यू आर गोइंग टू गेट फ्रॉम द स्टॉक एक्सपेक्टेड इज 3.16. देन प्राइस ऑफ द स्टॉक आफ्टर 1 ईयर, एनलिस्ट एस्टिमेट्स दैट इट इज 67.27. सो वॉट शुड बी द वैल्यू ऑफ स्टॉक टूडे? सो फॉर फाइंडिंग दैट वैल्यू वी हैव टू अज्यूम सर्टन रिक्वायर्ड रेट. नाउ रिस्क फ्री रेट इन कैनेडा इज अराउंड 2%, लेट्स से. प्लस दिस स्टॉक इज लिटिल रिस्की देन गवर्नमेंट ऑफ कैनेडा बॉन्ड. सो लेट्स से वी वॉन्ट 4% रिस्क प्रीमियम. सो कॉस्ट ऑफ कैपिटल और कॉस्ट ऑफ इक्विटी फॉर दिस स्टॉक इज 6%. सो वॉट विल बी वैल्यू टूडे? वैल्यू टूडे विल बी डिविडेंड 3.16 प्लस प्राइस एट द एंड डिवाइडेड बाय 1 प्लस 6%. ओके, सो द स्टॉक प्राइस टूडे बेस्ड ऑन अ 6% रिटर्न शुड बी $66. इट इज $63. सो इट इज लिटिल लेस देन आर कैलकुलेशन. ओके, और अदर वे टू लुक एट इट इज, यू नो दैट दिस स्टॉक शुड बी अराउंड 67 एट द एंड ऑफ 1 ईयर. सो 1 ईयर फ्रॉम नाउ दिस स्टॉक शुड बी एट द एंड एट $67. यू ऑल्सो नो दैट द एक्सपेक्टेड डिविडेंड इज $3.16. सो लेट अस से वी नो द स्टॉक प्राइस टूडे, इट इज $63. वी वॉन्ट टू फाइंड आउट हाउ मच रिटर्न इज द स्टॉक जनरेटिंग इफ ऑल एनालिस्ट आर करेक्ट एंड दिस स्टॉक गोज टू 67 एंड इट पेज यू 3.16% डिविडेंड. सो हाउ विल यू डू इट? यूल पुट इट इन दिस फॉर्मूला. 63 इक्वल्स 3.16 प्लस 67.27 डिवाइडेड बाय 1 प्लस RE. We want to know what is the required rate you are going to get. So if you cross multiply, it will be 3.16 plus 67.27 divided by 63. And I'm solving the bracket, solving the equation, and minus 1. So this stock is expected to return 11.79% if the analyst estimate of $67 comes true. Okay, other way to look at it. So this was valuation of a stock based on dividend and एक्सपेक्टेड रेट ऑफ रिटर्न। नाउ देयर आर सर्टेन थिंग्स यू नीड टू नो एज अ इन्वेस्टर इन स्टॉक। यू गेट डिविडेंड्स एंड कैपिटल गेन्स दैट कंपोजेस टोटल रिटर्न। सो एज अ इन्वेस्टर योर रिटर्न्स फ्रॉम द स्टॉक आर इक्वल्स टू, सो टोटल रिटर्न्स इक्वल्स डिविडेंड यील्ड प्लस कैपिटल गेन्स। सो इफ यू आर लुकिंग एट इट इन परसेंटेज टर्म्स दिस इज नथिंग बट डिविडेंड यील्ड इज कैलकुलेटेड एज डिविडेंड्स डिवाइडेड बाय प्राइस ऑफ द स्टॉक। कैपिटल गेन इज कैलकुलेटेड एज प्राइस एट द एंड ऑफ द ईयर P1 माइनस प्राइस एट द बिगिनिंग ऑफ द ईयर P0 बिकॉज यू आर ओनली इन्वेस्टिंग फॉर अ ईयर डिवाइडेड बाय प्राइस 0। ओके, सो डिविडेंड यील्ड इज कैलकुलेटेड एज D1 डिवाइडेड बाय प्राइस करंट प्राइस प्लस कैपिटल गेन इज नथिंग बट हाउ मच डिड द स्टॉक इंक्रीज। सो प्राइस 1 माइनस प्राइस 0 द इंक्रीज इन द स्टॉक डिवाइडेड बाय करंट प्राइस। सो दिस इज हाउ टोटल रिटर्न्स यू गेट फ्रॉम अ स्टॉक डिविडेंड यील्ड प्लस कैपिटल गेन्स। ओके, दैट इज व्हाट दे हैव डन। डिविडेंड यील्ड D1 डिवाइडेड बाय P0 प्लस price at the end of the year minus price at the beginning of the year divided by P0, that is capital gain rate. The expected total returns of the stock should equal the expected return of other investments available in the market with the equivalent risk. So expected return RE that we were looking at is nothing but the return that you expect from the stock because of the risk that you are taking. They have given few examples, so let's do that. Suppose you expect Loblaws to pay an annual dividend of 0.56 per share in the coming year and to trade at 45.50 per share at the end of the year. If the investment having equivalent risk to Loblaws has an expected return of 6.8, what is this value of the stock, right? What is the dividend yield and what is the capital gain rate? So let's calculate it. So certain things are given to you. So what are given to you? Annual dividend 0.56. So D1 is given $0.56. Okay. Then price 1 is given at the end of the year 45.50. Then RE is given 6.8. Okay, they are asking you to find value of the stock. So first value of the stock is D1 0.56 plus price 1 divided by 1 plus RE. Okay, so value of the stock should be, the price of the stock should be 43.12. Then they are asking you to calculate dividend yield and capital gain rate. Okay, dividend yield is nothing but dividend received D1 divided by price today 43.12. Okay, dividend received divided by price today. This was pre-zero that you calculated. Okay. Then CGR is nothing but how much the stock grows to. So 45 P1 minus 43 P0 divided by P0. Okay. So if you add both of them, it should be 6.8. So 6.8% return you are getting on the stock, 1.2% you get in form of dividends, and 5.5% you get because the stock is appreciating. So they have solved that. Use this formula. We did that, 43.13. Dividend yield 0.56 divided by 43.13, 1.30. And capital gain rate 45.50 minus 43, 2.37 divided by 43.13, 5.50. So at the price of 43.13, LogBoss expected return is dividend yield plus capital gain appreciation. This is nothing but, this is also called as cost of capital, cost of equity. Okay, cost of equity is nothing but based on the risk of the company, how much returns would the equity holders expect. This amount is the most we would be willing to pay for Loblaw stock. If we paid more than our expected, more, our expected return would be less than 6.8% and we would rather invest elsewhere. So based on this value, if the stock is trading at 43.13 or below, then you should buy because your returns would be at least 6.8 or more. But if the stock is trading at more than 43.13, then your returns will be less than 6.8%. So you shouldn't invest. Now, this was a 1 year investor, right? But sometimes you invest for multi years. Suppose we plan to hold the investment for 2 years. What would you do? So value today will be dividend you receive in year one. You discount it to today's term. Then second year you are going to get dividend plus you're going to sell the stock. So then you have to discount this again to today's term. So it will be dividend plus 1 plus RE, that is 1 year discounting, and then dividend 2 plus price at the end of 2 years, 2 years discounting. So it is always present value of future dividends. So if you keep on scaling it, if you hold the stock forever, dividend discount model is based on an assumption that you're not going to sell this stock, you're going to hold the stock forever. Then you can revise the formula. You can revise the formula as P0 equals dividend in year one divided by cost of equity, that is based on risk of the stock, minus a variable called as G, which is growth rate in dividend. So once again, I'm going to explain. The dividend discount model assumes that you're going to hold this stock forever. Unless and until the company is bad, you're not going to sell it. So then in that case, the price of the stock today equals dividend you received in the first, means the upcoming dividend, the first dividend that you're going to receive, divided by RE, that is cost of equity, minus G, where D1, dividend 1, is the next dividend. RE is cost of equity based on the risk of the company, and G is growth rate of dividend. Okay, G is growth rate of dividend. Okay, so they have given an example. So one we'll do from the slides and then I'll take an example of TD also. So Hydro One is regulated utility company that services in Ontario. Suppose Hydro plans to pay $2.3 per share in dividend in the upcoming year. If the cost of capital is 7% based on Hydro's risk and dividends are expected to grow by 2%, what is the value of Hydro stock today? So how to do that? They have given you certain things. The expected dividend, plans to pay $2.3. So it is expected dividend. So first thing you have to always worry, is the dividend today given or the expected dividend is given? If dividend today is given, D0, then you have to compute D1, right? So if in this case directly they have given D1 because 2.3 is plans to pay. So it's going to pay that dividend. But in certain cases, D0 is given. So in that case, you have to calculate D1 from D0 by using this formula. D1 equals D0 into 1 plus G. Only use this formula when D0 is given, that is current paid dividend is given. If expected dividend is given, do not use this formula. Directly note down D1. Then RE is 7% based on the risk of the company, and G they are saying is 2%. The dividends are growing at 2%. So value of the stock or price of the stock right now equals 2.3 dividend in the expected dividend next year divided by R E 7% minus G 2%. So the price of the stock should be $46. Price of the stock should be $46. So that's what they have done. 2.3 divided by 7% minus 2% comes to 46 bucks. Okay. So effectively you are willing to pay 20 times this year's dividend of $2.3 to own Hydro's one stock, because you're buying claim to this year's dividend and an infinite growth series. So it is assuming that you will never sell the stock. Okay. So before going to the next one, let's actually do it for some stocks. So this is TD. The current expected dividend is 3.16. So let's see if TD makes a good case of investment based on dividend discount model. So dividend expected right now is 3.16. So dividend 1 is 3.16. Let us say I want 10% return on this stock. So my based on the risk that TD has, I expect 10% return on this stock. Okay. And we need G, the growth rate of dividends for this stock. So let's see what has been the growth rate of dividends. So growth dividends are given in historical data. So I don't want prices. I want dividends. And max. Apply. So this is dividend information. The last quarter dividend was 0.79. And in 1995, it gave 5 cents of dividend. So the dividend has grown from 0.05 in 1995 to last quarter's dividend was 0.79 in 2020. So how many years have passed? 25 years have passed. What is the rate of growth of these dividends? So if you calculate rate, 25 years have passed, zero, that's not payments. We want to know that initially the dividend was 5 cents. Now it is 79 cents. So what is the growth rate of dividend? So growth rate of dividend itself is 11.6%. So let us say I want 15% return on this stock. So dividend currently is 3.16. I want 15% return on this stock, and the growth rate of dividend is 11.67%. Now let's value, let's calculate value of this stock. And how is, what is our logic? If market price is less than value, then generally you buy the stock because returns will be more than 15%. That was our assumption. If market price is greater than value, then you will sell the stock. So let's calculate value. Expected dividend 3.16 divided by 15% I want from this stock. The dividend growth rate is 11.67. So this stock should trade at $94 right now based on the growth rate it has shown in dividends. Okay. What is the stock price right now? Stock price is $63. So it is less than our calculated price. So if you buy the stock right now and this continues, this growth rate of dividend continues, then in the next 25 years, you are expected to get more than 15% because the stock is currently less than 94. Okay. So if a stock is less than value calculated by you, it's an undervalued company. You can buy it. If it is greater, then it is an overvalued company. And which is in fact true, because if you calculate the returns given by TD in the last 25 years, the returns have been more than 15%. So TD has given excellent returns in the last 25 years. Now, I don't know what's going to happen from here on, but if you expect the dividends to continue growing at this rate, then you can invest in TD. Okay. Now let's do one more thing. Let us say that the stock price of TD is 63.28 and you want 15% return. So what should be the growth rate of dividends? Okay. So how to calculate that? We put it in this formula. 63.28, the value of the stock, equals dividend 3.16 divided by 15% RE minus G. We want to calculate G. So it will be 3.16 divided by 63.28 is 4%, right? So this went there. Okay, so it should be 15% minus whatever you calculated. So dividends should grow at 10% to justify the current valuation. Okay. Next concept, dividend versus investment and growth, a simple model of growth. Dividend each year is equals to firm's earning per share multiplied by the dividend payout rate. So dividend are paid from earnings. So how does it work? The dividend that you receive is nothing but earning per share EPS into dividend payout rate. This we saw in chapter 2. Dividend you received is nothing but earning per share EPS, earnings divided by shares outstanding into dividend payout rate. Okay. A simple model of growth, a firm can increase its dividends in three ways. So based on this thing, when will dividends increase? Dividends can increase in three ways. It can increase when EPS goes up, earnings grow up. It can increase when dividend payout ratio increases, and it can increase when the number of share outstanding decreases. So once again, I'll explain it in Excel. So what are they saying? They are saying that value of the firm depends on dividends according to dividend discount model. Now the dividend depends on earnings divided by share outstanding into So whole thing into dividend payout ratio. Now, a firm can increase its value or firm can increase its dividend by doing three things: increase earnings, right? Second, increase payout ratio. Payout ratio is nothing but how much dividends do you pay from your earnings. So what is the percentage that you pay from your earnings? Increase payout ratio. And third one, decrease shares outstanding. Okay. So you can increase value of a firm or dividends of a firm by increasing the earnings, making more money, increasing the payouts that you give to shareholders, or decrease the number of shares. Okay. If all increase in future earnings results exclusively from new investment made with the retained earnings, then changes in earnings equals. So what they are saying is, if a company is stagnant, how will it grow? It will grow by making new investments. So any change in earning that the company can get equals new investment that is making into return on that investment. Okay. Again, new investment equals the firm's earning multiplied by retention ratio. So new investment equals earnings into retention rate. So where would you make new investments from? You would make new investments from earnings. So some earnings you would retain in the business to invest. Now that is nothing but earnings that you had into how much are you retaining. Okay. So nothing but you can rewrite this growth formula with retention rate into return on new investments. Retention rate into return on new investments. So what the bottom line was, this G can also be written as new investments the firm is making, growth of dividends will depend on the growth that the company expects, that is based on new investments, into return on new investments. Okay, which can again be written as retention rate into return. So how to actually do that? So future growth of any company would depend on how much retention rate is there into return on its investment that it generally makes. So I generally use a different formula, a little bit of a modification to this formula, because you don't know how much return the new investments are going to make. So I use this formula, retention rate into return on equity. Return on equity is whatever return the company is making for shareholders in past. So I assume that this is going to continue in future too. So whatever new investment it is making, it will at least consider return on equity that it is producing. So that will be G. So how to do that? So you'll understand more. So let's do it for TD. Do they give ratios? Nope, they don't give ratios. So let's calculate ratios. So what is retention rate? Retention rate is 1 minus dividend payout rate. So they're not giving dividends here. Let's Google it. I can open Bloomberg, but it will take a lot of time to open. So dividend payout ratio of TD Bank. So dividend payout ratio is 59%. So every $1 earning it makes, it pays 59% as dividend. So how much is it retaining? So it is retaining 1 minus whatever it is paying. So 59% it pays, 41% it keeps. So this is the retention rate. Then what is the return it generally generates on investments? So we want return on equity of TD. Return on equity was 14.6%. ROE is 14.6%. So what is G? G in this case is returns on new investment is it is making into retention rate, whatever earnings it is retaining. So G is actually the expected growth rate on dividends is actually 6%. It is not 11% like in the past. It grew very fast in the past. But in future, the expected G from this company is going to be 5.99%. So if you value it now, so let's assume it is 6% and I want 12% return on this stock. The expected dividend is 3.16. So if you value it, so 3.16 divided by R minus G. So this stock should trade at 52. It is trading little bit above that. So it is not generating 12% return. It is generating less than that. So how much return it is generating? This stock is at 63. So if you want to calculate returns, 63 equals 3.16 divided by RE minus 6%. So it will be 3.16 divided by 63. So this plus 6%. So based on the current price, you should expect 11% return from TD. Based on the current price, you should expect 11% return from TD. Okay. So they have given an example. Let's do that. The Canadian Tire Corporation Limited expects to have earning per share of $6 in the coming year. Rather than invest these earnings and grow, the firm plans to pay out all its earnings as dividends. So it is paying entire $6 as dividend. With these expectation of no growth, Canadian Tire's current price is 60. Now it is changing something. Suppose the Canadian Tire cuts its dividend payout ratio to 75% for the foreseeable future and use these retained earnings to open new stores. The return on investment is expected to be 12% on these stores. If we assume that the risk of these investment is the same, then firm's cost of capital is unchanged. What would be the impact on Canadian Tire stock price? So what are they saying is, currently, Canadian Tire stock price is $60 and the dividend it pays is, what was the dividend? $6. Okay, $6. Also, they have given the return is 12%. Return expected is 12%. Okay. So this was given to you. Now they are saying that instead of paying this entire dividend out, it is changing something. So it is going to retain. So first of all, its earnings are $6. It is going to pay out 75% of it as dividends. So $4.5, and it's going to retain $1.5. So its retention ratio is 25%. Okay, they're asking you to calculate value of Canadian Tires. Does it increase or does it decrease? So let's do that. For calculating value, we need D1 dividend in year 1 divided by R minus G. So for calculating, we have D1. D1 is payout of $4.5. So $6 earning, out of that it pays $4.5. So we have the payout. We have the R. R is 12%. We don't know G. So what is G? G is retention rate into return on investment, ROI. So retention rate is 25%, return on investment is 12%. So our G is 3%. So if you calculate value of this stock, it will be $4.5 divided by R, that is 12%, minus G, that is 3%. So this stock value drops down to $60. Okay, so they have calculated it. Okay, first of all, this is not RE, this is new investment. So this is ROI, not RE. This is given as ROI. So we actually have to calculate RE. But RE we know, RE is nothing but dividend payout, dividend yield into capital appreciation. So we know the current dividend is $6 divided by 60 bucks. Plus capital appreciation is not there because it is not retaining any profits. It is distributing all dividends in the base case. So RE becomes actually 10%. So this was little bit wrong. So this was RE is 10%, G is 3%, dividend is 4.5. So value of the stock equals 4.5 divided by RE 10% minus G. So they hadn't given us RE. RE we had to calculate. They had given us ROI, return on investments, right? So the value of the stock is 64. The current price is 60. So the stock price would appreciate by 4 bucks if it retains some profits. Okay, so $64 is the expected price of Canadian Tires. So Canadian Tires should rise from 60 to 64 if it cuts the dividends and reinvests it at 12%. Now, why is it able to do that? Because the rate of return on new investment is 12%, which is greater than cost of capital 10%. So if your rate of investment, we'll study this in capital budgeting too. If your rate of return from any new investment you make is greater than the cost of capital for that business, for that decision, then you will increase the shareholders' value. Now they have also said what will happen if it cuts the dividend to 75%, so same thing, but the return on investment is 8% rather than 12%. So let's assume instead of 12% return on investment, this is 8%. So what will happen? G will change. G will be retention rate 25% into return on investment, that is 8%. So it comes to 2%. So G changes to 2. So this will be 4.5 divided by 10 minus 2. So it comes to 56. So share price will fall by $4. So it is always important that the new investments you are making should generate more returns than your cost of capital. So they have done that. So it comes to $56. So even though Canadian Tires will grow under the new policy, the new investment has negative NPV. The company share price will fall if it cuts its dividend and invest at 8%. So whatever new investment the Canadian Tire plans, it should generate more than 10% return. So whatever money it is putting, it should have returns more than 10%. Now, sometimes what happens is the growth rates for companies are not constant. The firm initially doesn't pay any dividend, then it starts paying dividend, or the firm grows faster in initial years, then slower in future years. So the growth rates may not be constant. If a firm is expected to grow at long-term rate G after N plus 1 years, then according to constant growth model, PN equals to dividend N plus 1 divided by R minus G, RE minus G, and then you discount it back. So I'll give you an example. So let us look at a company that doesn't pay any dividend. So Facebook doesn't pay any dividend. Okay. So current price is 258. Now, what is happening? The current Facebook price is 258. I'm investing in the stock. I expect it currently doesn't pay any dividend, but after 10 years, when Facebook matures, I'm expecting a $4 dividend from Facebook. So dividend in at the end of 10 years, that is dividend in 11th year, is expected to be $4. Okay. I also expect the dividends to grow at 4%, and based on the risk, my cost of capital to invest in Facebook is 12%. I want to find out what should be the value of Facebook today. So how to do that? Now it's not paying dividend right now. So for next 10 years, it's not going to pay any dividend. Okay, 11th year it is going to pay $4 of dividend. So I want to find out value right now, but next it's not going to pay any dividends for 10 years. So how do I value? So I'll use dividend growth formula to find value in the 10th year. Because what is dividend growth formula? P0 equals D1 divided by R minus G. So in this case, I'll get P10 value of stock in the 10th year based on dividend in the 11th year, 4 divided by R minus G. What is R? R is 12% minus G. G is 4%. So if you copy this, and click equals to. So price of the stock would be $50, right, after 10 years. So what should be price today? So this is 10 years, so you have to discount it back to today's time. So present value at cost of capital 12% ओके, फ्यूचर वैल्यू 50, नंबर ऑफ इयर्स 10, क्लिक ऑन इक्वल्स टू, सो द स्टॉक प्राइस शुड बी 16 बक्स, एंड जस्ट द स्टॉक प्राइस इज 250 है, सो इट्स नॉट गोइंग टू हैपन. दिस फेसबुक में पे मोर डिविडेंड देन 4 बक्स, मे बी इट इज पेइंग $50 आफ्टर 10 ईयर्स. So maybe the stock price could be 201. So maybe it is paying $50 after 10 years. Who knows? But this is how to value it. Companies that don't pay dividend, figure out when they could start paying dividend, value the stock 1 year before, and bring it back to today's terms. So let's see. Small Fry Inc. has just invented a potato chip that looks and tastes like French fry. Given the phenomenal market response to this product, Small Fry is reinvesting all its earnings to expand its operations. Earnings are currently $2 per share in the past year and expected to grow at 20% per year until the end of 4 years. At this point, other companies are likely to bring out competing products. Analysts project that at the end of year 4, Small Fry would cut its investment and begin paying out 60% of its earnings as dividends. Its growth will also slow to a long run rate of 4% instead of 20% right now. If Small Fry's equity cost is 8%, what is the value of share today? So, how to do that? We can use Small Fry's projected earnings growth rate and dividend payout to forecast the future earnings. After 4 years, the fry's dividends will grow at 4% constant. So we can use constant dividend growth rate to value its earnings. Finally, we'll pull everything together with the dividend discount model. So how will it work? Current earnings are $2. Next year's earnings, they will grow by 20%. So $2 grow by 20%, 2.4. 2.8, 3.46, then 4.15, then 4.31, and then it will start growing by 4%. So initial 4 years it grows by 20%, then it will start growing by 4% constant into future. Now currently for 4 years it's not going to pay any dividend. So end of 1 year it's not paying, end of 2 years it's not paying, end of 3 years it's not paying, but fourth year it's going to pay dividend of 60%. Okay, so the dividend you are going to receive is $2.49. Then again you will receive a dividend of 60%, so whatever earnings you make out of that 60% you will pay as dividends, so 2.59, and then again 60% dividend, so 2.69. So from fourth year onwards, whatever dividends you make, you're going to pay out 60% of that as dividends. So starting from $2, earnings are growing by 20% per year until fourth year, after which the growth slow down to 4%. Small Fry's dividend payout ratio is zero until year four, when the competition reduces its investment opportunities and its payout rises to 60%. Multiplying EPS by dividend payout, we project Small Fry's dividend in line 4. So, how to value it? So, you have to calculate going back. So, from here onwards, the dividends are getting constant. They're going to grow by 4 years. So, you have to calculate value at the end of 3 years. So, how to find it out? Dividend in the fourth year, 2.49, okay, divided by RE minus G, 8% minus 4%. That is nothing but $62.25 is the share value in the third year. Then bring it back 62.25 for 3 years at 8%. So that comes to 49.42. So how to value it? So the year from which the dividends are getting constant, value that stock in that year, then bring it back to today's terms, right? By discounting it. The dividend discount model is flexible enough to handle any forecasted patterns of dividends. Here, the dividends were zero for first 3 years and then settled into a constant growth rate, allowing us to use constant growth rate as a shortcut. Okay, so let's continue. So we have discussed dividend discount model, which is nothing but value of a share is present value of future dividend you are going to receive from the stock. So the dividend discount model includes an implicit forecast of firm's profitability, which is discounted back at firm's cost of capital. The problem with dividend discount model is sometimes the dividend forecasts are not certain. The dividend discount model values a stock based on a forecast of future dividend, but a firm's future dividend may carry a tremendous amount of uncertainty. Sometimes there may be stocks that do not pay any dividends. Many companies do not pay dividends, thus the dividend discount model must be modified. So, there are two modifications that we are going to work on. The first modification is called the share repurchase model, and the second modification is free cash flow model. So the share repurchase model says sometimes the firm pays dividends, but along with that it also repurchases the shares. So the profit, that the value that you have in the stock, is nothing but present value of the dividends you're going to receive plus the present value of share repurchase that you're going to get. So the firm uses cash to buy back its own stock. Consequences: there is more cash the firm uses to repurchase the stock, the less cash it is available for paying dividends. By repurchasing shares, the firm decreases the share count, which increases its earnings and dividends going forward. So what happens is, if you're repurchasing the stock, if a company is repurchasing the stock, what happens? The share count, the outstanding share, decreases, which has two impacts. First, the earning per share goes up. Second, the dividend per share goes up because there are less shareholders to distribute those dividends. So whoever is left gets more dividends. So how to value such firms if they're doing share repurchases? In a dividend discount model, a share value is valued from a perspective of a single shareholder. Discounting the dividends the shareholder will receive. So current value is present value of future dividend per share. But in a payout model, that is the modification that we are making, we use present value of future dividends and repurchases divided by share outstanding, that is the share price. So value of all firm's equity rather than a single share is to be considered. To use this model, discount the total payouts that the firm makes to the shareholder, which is the total amount spent on dividends as well as share repurchase. So not only do we consider dividends, we also consider share repurchases. And how to consider it? Calculate the present value. So they have given an example. So again, let's go through that. So this industries has 217 million shares outstanding and expects earnings at the end of the year to be $860 million. It plans to pay out 30% of its earning as dividend and 20% of its earning through share repurchases. If earnings are expected to grow by 7.5% and the payout ratio determines the share price, assuming cost of capital is 10%. So how to do it? What is the share value? So let's see how they have calculated it. Based on the equity cost of capital 10% and an expected growth rate of 7.5%, we can compute present value of futures payout as a constant growth perpetuity. The only input missing is total payout this year, which we can calculate as 50% of earnings, 30% by dividend and 30% by repurchases. The present value of all future payout is the value of total equity. To obtain the price, we divide it by number of shares. So what they are doing is, so pay attention. The company is making $830 million. Was it 830? Yeah, 860. So company is making $860 million. Okay, out of that, 20% it pays as dividends, and 30% it pays as share repurchases. So value of this stock or price of this stock at time zero equals present value PV of, so how to do that? We have to calculate present value of share repurchases plus dividends, right? And divided by number of shares, divided by current number of shares, right? That is what they are doing. So first of all, calculating present value. So share repurchases plus dividend is nothing but add them up. $430 million. So present value PV equals dividend discount model. 430 million total output, dividend plus share purchases, divided by rate of return that the company has, 10% cost of capital, minus growth rate. Growth rate is 7.5%. Okay, so this is present value of future dividends that at time zero. So what do you do after this? After you have calculated it, 17.2 billion, you divide it by number of shares. So current number of shares is 217. So the share price comes to 79.26. So what do you do? The only difference between this problem and whatever we have done in past is, in this case, the company is repurchasing its own shares. So in this case, what do? Calculate the present value of repurchase plus dividend, and by dividing it by rate of cost of capital minus growth rate, and then divide it by number of shares to get per share value. Using the payout model, we did not need to know the firm split between dividend and share purchases. To compute this method, the dividend discount model will pay a dividend of 30% for a dividend yield of 1.5%, and EPS, expected EPS, dividend and share price growth, we know it's cost of capital minus dividend yield, so it is 8.5%. This growth rate exceeds 9.5% growth rate of earnings because the share count will decline over time owing to share repurchases. Okay, so what they have done is they have calculated the new growth rate, and the growth rate exceeds the growth rate that we use because the share count is going down. Okay, the next one is free cash flow method. So this is the second approach of doing it when dividends are not to be used. So instead of using dividend, we are going to use free cash flows. So the discounted free cash flow model determines the total value of the firm's productive assets to all investors, both equity and debt. So enterprise value is now, we have seen it in module 2, chapter 2. Enterprise value is market value of stocks plus debt minus cash. So valuing an enterprise, to estimate a firm's enterprise value, we compute the present value of firm's cash flow, FCF, available to all investors. How do we calculate free cash flow? It is nothing but earnings before interest and tax, adjusted by one minus tax. So this is operating profit. You add non-cash expenses like depreciation, you reduce capital expenditure, and you reduce increase in net working capital. So we'll make a pro forma on how to do it. So free cash flow to firm, FCF, is nothing but earning before interest and tax, right? मल्टीप्लाइड बाय 1 माइनस टैक्स प्लस डेप्रिसिएशन माइनस कैपिटल एक्सपेंडिचर माइनस नेट इंक्रीज इन वर्किंग कैपिटल. सो इफ आई पुट इट इन लाइन आइटम द फॉर्मेट विल बी एबिट, यू नोट डाउन द एबिट, यू नोट डाउन द टैक्स, यू सब्ट्रैक्ट द टैक्स. Okay, then you subtract, then you add depreciation, okay, then you subtract capital expenditure, and then you subtract increase in working capital. And then you get free cash flow to firm. Okay? This is how you calculate free cash flow. Then free cash value of a firm, while enterprise value of a firm is present value of free cash flow to the firm, right? And then we find out value of equity. So it's a three-step process. First, calculate free cash flow. Second, calculate present value of free cash flow. FCF. How to do that? Formula is FCF divided by cost of capital. So it is not equity, weighted average cost of capital minus growth rate. So this is how you calculate present value. First, you calculate FCF, calculate present value. Third step, calculate value of stock. How to calculate value of stock? It's using the formula V0, that is present value of FCF plus cash minus debt and the whole thing divided by share outstanding. Okay, so using free cash flows, sometimes dividends are not known for firms. So instead of using dividends, you can use free cash flows. How to do that? Step one, calculate free cash flow to the firm. Take EBIT, adjust it by tax, add depreciation, reduce capital expenditure, reduce increase in working capital, get free cash flows. Then calculate present value of free cash flows. How to do that? Free cash flow to the firm divided by weighted average cost of capital minus growth rate means the formula that we are going to use. Then value the stock using present value of cash plus debt plus present value of free cash flow plus cash minus debt divided by share outstanding. Okay, so implementing the model, since we are discounting free cash flow, we use weighted average cost of capital instead of using cost of equity. So the weighted average cost of capital reflects the risk of overall business, which is combined risk of firm's equity and debt. So we use this formula. Free cash flow next year divided by weighted average cost of capital minus growth of free cash flows, right? If free cash flow next year is not known, we can use current cash flows, free cash flows, and adjust it by 1 plus growth rate. The long run growth rate, GFCF, is based on expected long term growth rates of revenues. So let's do an example. Nike had sales of 25 billion in 2012. Suppose you expect its sales to grow at the rate of 10% in 2013, but then slow by 1% per year to long-term growth rate that is characterized by 5%. So each year it is going to slow down by 1%. Based on Nike's past profitability and investment needs, you expect EBIT to be 10% of the sales इंक्रीज इन वर्किंग कैपिटल टू बी 10% ऑफ एनी इंक्रीज इन सेल्स एंड कैपिटल एक्सपेंडिचर इक्वल टू डेप्रिसिएशन एक्सपेंसेस. इफ नाइकी हैड $3.3 बिलियन इन कैश, $1.2 बिलियन इन डेट एंड 893 मिलियन शेयर्स आउटस्टैंडिंग, अ टैक्स रेट ऑफ 24% एंड अ वेटेड एवरेज कॉस्ट ऑफ कैपिटल ऑफ 10%, वॉट इज योर एस्टिमेट? So let's see the solutions. We can estimate Nike's future free cash flow by constructing a pro forma statement. Further, we need to calculate the terminal value of Nike at the end of our projections because we expect Nike's free cash flow to grow at a constant rate after 2018. We can compute a terminal enterprise value. The present value of free cash flows during the year 2013 and the terminal value will be total enterprise value. From that value, we can subtract debt, add cash and divide it by number of shares. So we are going to use this format. First, calculate free cash flows, make projections, calculate present value of those cash flows and then add cash minus debt and divide it by share outstanding. So if you do it, this is how the solution looks. Sales are 25,300 right now. They are going to grow 10% next year. So this grows by 10%. Then this grows by 9%. This grows by 8%, 7%, 6%, 5%, and then stabilizes at 5% growth. EBIT is 10% of sales. So 10% of this we calculate. 10% of this you calculate. 10% of this you calculate. 10%, 10%, and 10%. Reduce tax. Tax is 24% of EBIT. So 24%, 24%, 24%, 24%. Okay, there is no depreciation or capital expenditures given, so we leave it blank. Increase in working capital is 10% of increase in sales. So whatever sales have increased, take 10% of that. Whatever sales have increased, take 10% of that, so on and so forth. So finally, you get free cash flows. It is EBIT minus tax minus increase in working capital. So you get free cash flows. Now you can see that after 2018, it is going to constantly grow at 5%. So you need to calculate a terminal value at 2018 using perpetual dividend discount moments using free cash flow perpetual model. So how to do that? Because the capital expenditure are expected to equal depreciation, they cancel out. Given the assumption of constant 5% growth in free cash flow after 2020 and a weighted average cost of 10%, you can find out the terminal value. So terminal value in 2018 is cash flows in 2018. They are growing by 1 plus G divided by rate of weighted average cost minus growth rate. So 1.050 into 2779, that was the terminal value here, right? Divided by 10% minus 5%. So you get enterprise value of 58.537 in 2018. Now you need to bring that term enterprise value to 2012. So enterprise value today is cash flows next year divided by 1 plus weighted average cost of capital. Cash flow next year divided means bringing it by 2 years, bringing this 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, 6 years, and the last one for 6 years again because we calculated terminal value. So it comes to 42,881.5 million. We can now estimate the value of stock. Value of stock is the present value that you calculated, present enterprise value plus cash minus debt divided by number of shares outstanding. So it comes to 50.34. So total value of all claims, both debt and equity on the firm, must equal the total present value of cash flows generated by the firm in addition to any cash it currently has. The total present value of all cash flows generated by Nike is 48 million and it has 3 million in cash. So add cash, subtract debt, you get the share price. Two important thing about valuation models: they are only good at the time they are made As time goes by, the data and assumptions used in the valuation model will change, so will the value. They use projections of what will happen, but these projections are subjected to a lot of errors. We are estimating that Nike increases sales by this rate. It may or may not happen. So it valuation model depends on projections. So the bottom line is, whenever a firm is looking to add any project, if that project is generating more than the cost of capital involved to build that project, that will increase the share price. If that project is generating less than cost of capital, it will decrease share price. The firm's future cash flows in any particular year is equal to the sum of that year's free cash flow and future investment projects. The firm's enterprise value equals the total value that the firm will generate from continuing its existing project and initiating new ones. NPV of any project is contribution to firm's enterprise value. To maximize share price, we should accept projects that have positive benefits. So what is net present value? Net present value is benefits from the project minus cost of starting the project. If that is positive, the share price would increase. Now, many forecasts like future sales, operating expenses, taxes, capital requirements are necessary to estimate free cash flows, and thus there are a lot of assumptions that go into free cash flow modeling. Estimating free cash flows gives us the flexibility to incorporate many specific details about future prospects of the firm. The disadvantage of this model is some uncertainty surrounds each assumption. A sensitivity analysis shows how our final value calculated will change. So, example, we have assumed that earnings before interest and tax is 10% of sales, right? If Nike can reduce its operating expenses and increase EBIT to 11%, what would happen? So EBIT is increasing by 1% of sales. From there, we can use tax rate to compute. So you can use 11% instead of 10%. In this problem, instead of 10% of sales, you can use 11% of sales. So Nike is able to control its cost, so more profits are generated for sales. So what will be the net impact? Net impact will be this would be the cash flows instead of previous ones. So if you calculate the value, the share price comes to $55, which is a difference of 10% compared to the previous one that we calculated. The previous one we calculated was $50, but if it can control its cost, the share price would be $55. Okay? Nike's stock price is fairly sensitive to changes in the assumptions about its profitability. A 1% permanent change in its margin affects the stock price by 10%. Another application of valuation principle is methods of comparable. So what is methods of comparable? Methods of comparable is where you use valuation multiples. Instead of using free cash flows, you use multiples that similar companies are valued on. An estimate of the firm's value is based on value of other comparable firms or other investments that are expected to generate similar cash flows in the future.